Praise God, church. Praise God. This is the day that the Lord has made, that we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I believe that you have had an amazing day, a good day, and that even as you're at home, we'd like to thank God for, you know, just having a good day and being able to sit down and listen to the word of God. We'd like to thank you for tuning in, for listening, for just being here to support this ministry, to be able to just hear the word of God, even during this trying times. We know that, you know, the curfew was extended, and to some people they were very discouraged, but we know that God is our strength, and we pray that God may give you the spirit of encouragement, even in the name of Jesus. My name is Valencia Jibera, coming live to you from Pentecostal Revival Church Makongeni under the able leadership of Bishop Osham Ominde. And it's such a blessing and a privilege to be able to be here to share the word of the Lord with us. And before we get to the word of God, I'd like us to just say a short prayer, even in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for the gift of health. We thank you because throughout the day you have been faithful. You have kept us. You have been with us, Lord. You have protected us. We thank you, my God, that even as we prepare to listen to your word, that, Lord, may every person who is expectant, may their expectation may not be cut short. We pray that, Lord, you will give us revelation, wisdom, anoint my lips, my God. May you help me to be able to bring your word as you have purposed it to be. We pray, my Father, my God, that you will lift our spirits, that you will use me to be able to speak your word, even in the name of Jesus we have prayed. Amen and amen. So today we're going to speak about from the book of Ephesians chapter 3 from verses 1. And I'll read, "For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles." And today I'd like us to talk about prisoner of Christ. Amen. Why would Paul call himself a prisoner of Christ? Because most of us, the term prisoner, the way we understand prisoner, what we know about a prisoner is not something that any of us would like to be. I don't know whether you've ever been arrested or you've ever been, you know, in remand for a day or two for, you know, one mistake or the other. It's not a very good place to be. It's not somewhere you would wish to be. It's actually somewhere where people really avoid. Because being a prisoner, you are limited. You have no freedom whatsoever. You feel like you're trapped. And when I read this verse, I was wondering, why would Paul call himself a prisoner of Christ? And so let us go to the Genesis of Ephesians chapter 3 verses 1. You see, in Acts chapter 21 from verses 27, actually if you read the entire of Acts chapter 21, Paul had been falsely accused by the Jews. The Jews had been looking for a reason to arrest him and even kill him, because they thought that Paul was teaching against the law, that Paul was teaching the opposite of what they wanted to be taught. And they did not want Paul to continue preaching the word of God as he was preaching and teaching. And so the Jews falsely accused Paul, and they accused him of taking a Greek man to a place in the temple where it is forbidden for him to enter into that place. And when the Jews accused Paul of that, the other Jewish people that were around the temple, they got quite mad. They got very angry with Paul, and so they dragged him, literally dragged him from the temple, and they started beating him up, and they wanted to kill him. But as you know, as the commotion was ongoing, there was a chief captain around the area, and the chief captain took some of the centurions and the soldiers, and they went towards that place, and they were asking people, "What is going on? What is going on?" And they had to arrest Paul for his own safety, because the Jews would have killed him. The Jews would have finished him. And Paul told the chief captain that he was a Roman citizen. And even before Paul actually told the chief captain that he was a Roman citizen, he asked the chief captain if he could be allowed to say something, if he could be allowed to speak to the people. And the chief captain allowed him to speak to the people. And Paul began testifying and giving his story and explaining to people how he changed from Saul to Paul, how his conversion happened, and why he was preaching the word of God, and what is his intention to preach the word of God. But the Jews did not want to listen to him. The Jews were angry at him. So whatever he said, it did not make sense to him. They were not listening to him objectively. They started shouting and they started protesting and they wanted to kill him. And because Paul saw that his life was in danger, he told the chief captain that I am a Roman citizen. And the chief captain knew that they were under the control of the Roman Empire at that particular time. And if Paul would have been killed by the Jews, being a Roman citizen, it would have put the chief captain in trouble, and the Romans would have probably, you know, I mean, the Romans would have killed, you know, the chief captains, and it would have become a big, big, big mess. And they knew that you could not kill a Roman citizen, that the chief captain had no power to kill or arrest a Roman citizen. And so what he did, once he confirmed, he asked Paul, are you sure that you're a Roman citizen? Child of God, you need to understand that Paul was born in Turkey. Yes, and he was a Roman citizen. And so when he said that he was a Roman citizen, the chief captain had to get him arrested and sent to Rome so that he could go through trial. And because there was no proof of guilt, he was taken to Rome and he became a prisoner in Rome. And so in Rome, he was arrested and he was placed in prison for 2 years. He was chained to the Roman soldiers so that he could, to prevent him from escaping. And, you know, child of God, I can imagine where Paul was at that particular time. He was probably despaired. He was probably discouraged. He was wondering, why is it that I am arrested for preaching the word of God? He had done no wrong. He had been accused falsely, just like Jesus, by the Jews, because they did not want him to continue preaching the word of God. They did not want him to continue performing miracles. And so they had to find a way to kill him. But he did not call himself a prisoner of the Romans. He did not call himself a prisoner of the Jews, but he called himself a prisoner of Jesus Christ. And you see, God allowed Paul to be taken prisoner. And he was not only taken prisoner in a kawaida Roman prison, but he was a prisoner in the royal palace. And this is even seen in Philippians chapter 1, verses 13. And God allowed him to be a prisoner in the royal palace because that is where God wanted him to be at that particular time. Because God had a purpose for Paul, and Paul had to accomplish that purpose. He was there in the royal household so that God could expand his ministry, that now he could be able to convert the Romans who are in the royal palace. He could be able to convert them to Christianity and that they could be saved. And this is in Philippians chapter 4, verses 22. We see that there are Roman soldiers. There was a Roman chief who actually converted to Christianity because of Paul, because Paul was a prisoner there. And I can imagine that life as a prisoner is very difficult. It is not easy. You see, you do not have freedom. You do not have liberty. You do not, someone else controls what you do. You do not, you can't eat what you want. You can't eat when you want. You eat what has been given to you by the prison officials. You are not allowed to use the bathroom or the washrooms in private. You use it collectively. You do not have privacy anymore. You cannot choose who to even live with, because once you get into prison, they allocate someone who will be your cellmate. And so you do not have the power or the capacity to say that I want this to live with this person. No, they are the ones who choose who you're going to live with. And you could probably be living with, you could be in prison for a case like robbery, and then they bring your cellmate who is a murderer, or who is a rapist, or who is a serial killer. So you do not know who is going to be your cellmate. You are not even safe. And you see, life as a prisoner is quite difficult. It is very difficult. You have limited time for visiting. You have limited time to, you cannot do anything. You are not even allowed to have a cell phone. And it's actually illegal for you to have a cell phone unless, you know, you do it illegally. But you do not have even the freedom to make calls, because you must hide for you to do these things. And so it is a life where it is just four walls. You cannot go out. You cannot do anything. The only thing you do is wake up when you're allowed to wake up, go to sleep when they say it's time to sleep. Whether uko na usingizi or not, they don't care. When it's time to sleep, you sleep. And you can imagine right now, the freedom that you have, that you can get out and go to do your errands, that you can get out and go visit someone, that you can get out and just, you know, just chill and bask up in the sun. As a prisoner, you do not have those rights. And I can imagine that being in that kind of life, it is not easy. You only do what the prison warden has allowed you to do. You only speak what the prison warden has allowed you to speak. You are under full and total control of the prison warden and officials. They are the ones who make decisions for your life. They are the ones who decide what you are going to do, when you're going to do. They are the ones who have total control of you at that particular moment. Your freedom is curtailed to them. Your freedom is changed to them. And I can try to imagine that Paul, as a prisoner, as much as he was going through those things, as much as he did not have liberty, as much as he did not have freedom, he did not consider himself as a Roman prisoner, no. He did not consider himself as a Jewish prisoner, no. But he called himself a prisoner of Christ, because he knew it is because of Christ that he is there where he is, that it's because that Christ has guided his direction, that is leading him to be where he is, even though it's not a good place, even though it's not a place where he would have wanted to be, but it is because of Christ that he is there. And he is not there by chance. He is not there just because, you know, Christ wanted him there, but it's because there is a mission that he had to achieve. There is a purpose that he had to accomplish. And so he called himself a prisoner of Christ. You are not a prisoner of your circumstances. You are not a prisoner of your past. You are not a prisoner of people's opinion. You are not a prisoner of poverty. You are not a prisoner of a curse. You are not a prisoner of whatever people have. You are not a prisoner of failure. You are not a prisoner of debt. You should not chain yourself to your circumstance. You should not put yourself in a position where you feel like you are a prisoner of what is going on. You are not a prisoner of failure. You are not a prisoner of rejection. You are not a prisoner of the past. Because the past is gone, the new has come. You are not a prisoner of that. And you should stop putting yourself or considering yourself a prisoner of your circumstances, because that is where we all go wrong. And Paul was aware. He knew that if God wanted to release him from that prison, it was as simple as ABC. It was very simple for God to release him, to free him from the prison, because Paul was aware of how an angel freed Peter when he was in prison. Paul was aware that Philip, in the Bible, in Acts chapter 8 from verses 39 to 40, that God removed Philip from one place to another place without even Philip knowing, that Philip was in one place and all of a sudden he found himself in another place. And you can see this in Acts chapter 8 from verses 39 to 40. And Paul knew that it was not the iron bars that kept him away. He knew that it was not the Roman soldiers that were holding him in the prison. He knew that he was in prison because God wanted him there. And so he calls himself a prisoner of the Lord, instead a prisoner of man, instead a prisoner of circumstances, instead a prisoner of rejection, instead of a prisoner of false accusation. He called himself a prisoner of Christ. And I believe in the believer's context, a prisoner of Christ, it means one who is bonded to Christ, one who is bound to Christ, where God is in full and total control of your life, that you are not in prison like the prisoners of the world, that you are not in prison like the prisoners in committee or the prisoners in industrial area. No, it means that Jesus, that God is in total control of your life, that you are totally dependent on God, that you are under God's authority, that you are living under God's will, that you are obedient to God. And please get me well, that when I say a prisoner of Christ, I don't mean that you do not have any freedom, because the Bible says that him who the Son sets free is free indeed. Being a prisoner of Christ doesn't mean that you cannot live your life. No, it just means that God is in total authority over your life, that God is in total authority over every decision that you make, that you are free to go out there and you know, evangelize and go and do business and go and get married and go and do a great career. But in all those things, God is the one who is under authority. And that is what we mean by being a prisoner
of Christ. And Paul referred to himself as a prisoner of Christ in very many instances. We see this in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1. He still called himself a prisoner of Christ. And even in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8, he still calls himself a prisoner in Christ. And you see, in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1, he says, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called." So Paul knew. Paul did not call himself a prisoner of Christ to mean that ati amekaziwa maisha, that he does not have freedom. That is not what we mean by that. We just mean that God ordered, and God has ordered the steps, that God is the one who allowed him to be there. And Paul was a man who lived under the total sovereign control of God's will. And we see this in Acts chapter 20, from verses 22 to 24. "And now, behold, I go bound in the spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that shall befall me there, save that the Holy Spirit witnesses in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. But none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I may finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus, to testify the gospel of the grace of God." And so Paul knew that his life, he did not care if he was going to die when he was preaching the gospel, but he knew that he was going to do that which God has ordered him to do, that he was living under the total sovereign control of the Spirit of God, that for him he was being led by the Spirit, that he was not allowing circumstances, not even the threat of death, to stop him from living under the will of God. Some of us, we have stopped living under the will of God because of the circumstances in our lives, because right now so many things are happening. Some of us have lost our jobs, some of us our businesses have failed, some of us we are on unpaid leave for an uncertain amount of time. So many things are going wrong, and so we have allowed ourselves to be a prisoner of that circumstance. But we need to believe, we need to let God take total authority of our lives, that we start telling God that, "God, I know that this is what I am going through, that God, I know that I am in a period of uncertainty, that God, I know I need you, but you are my provision, and as I walk in your will, I pray that, God, you are going to set me free, that, Lord, you are going to help me come out with a testimony, because it is possible for you to come out of this stronger, that God can give you ideas, that God can allow you to come out of this even more prosperous than the time you were free, than the time before COVID-19. And you see, if Paul allowed himself to think or to say or to even perceive that the Jews or the Romans were in control of his life because he was a Roman prisoner, then he would have given up. He would become discouraged. He would have totally despaired. But because he knew God was in control, he could even rejoice in the trials. You see, whenever you put yourself in a position where you're a prisoner of poverty, where you are a prisoner of the past, where you're a prisoner of failure, where you're a prisoner of heartbreak, where you're a prisoner of rejection, if your mind takes you to that place where you feel that you are completely lost, that this poverty will kill you, that this disease will kill you, that this COVID-19 will render you useless and totally broke. If you're making yourself a prisoner of your circumstance, you're making yourself a prisoner of things that do not even have a place in your life, you should now consider yourself that you who are in Christ, you cannot live like them that are in the world. And it's in Acts chapter 21, verses 13. "Then Paul answered, 'What mean you to weep and to break my heart? For I am ready not to be bound only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus.'" And so, you know, it would be very, very weird that Paul, even in prison, that Paul, when he was going through all this rejection, when Paul was going through persecution, he kept on trusting in God. He kept on rejoicing. He kept on praying. He kept on praising. He kept on evangelizing the word of God. He kept on being strong in the Lord, because he knew that God, and if God allowed it, then God had a reason for whatever it is that he was going through. And you see, so many of us right now, we have stopped praying. We have stopped believing. We have stopped living. We have stopped living in hope, because we have been discouraged by this circumstance. We have been discouraged by this situation. We have been discouraged by what is going on. We have been discouraged by losing our jobs. We have been discouraged by everything that is going on in the world, that we have allowed ourselves to be a prisoner of the circumstance, to be a prisoner of COVID-19, to be a prisoner of the past, to be a prisoner of people's opinions about you, to be a prisoner of maybe the many times that you have tried to do a business and it has failed, and you have allowed yourself to put yourself in a position where you are now a prisoner of that what you are going through. And you see, trials help us grow. Child of God, you need to know that as long as you are in this world, you will always face challenges. You will always face trials. We will always face persecution. But you need to know that trials will help you grow. And God is glorified in the testimony of the trial. The Bible talks to me about Daniel. Daniel was a man of God who went through a lot of persecution. Because he refused to bow down and to worship to idols and to stop praying, he was actually thrown in a pit of a lion's den. But even when he was in that pit, he was not scared. He knew that his God was going to save him. He knew that if God allowed him to be there, then God had a plan. That God in his infinite wisdom knew exactly why Daniel was allowed to get into that pit. And because God is a God that fights our battles, he ensured that the lion did not kill Daniel, that he shut down the mouth of the lion. And I am here to tell you today that you may be in a pit of debt, a pit of worry, a pit of joblessness, a pit of despair, but God is going to shut down that mouth of the lion, that the despair will not kill you, that the joblessness will not kill you, that discouragement will not kill you, the persecution will not kill you, but you will come out of it in a testimony. The Bible tells me about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that this man, they refused to worship the idols, and they were thrown into the furnace of fire. And even when they were in the fire, they were not crying, they were not weeping, they were not discouraged, but they were walking around praising God, shouting, singing to God, praising and lifting the name of God. And as they were praising God in the fire, the fourth man came and walked with them in the fire, because they knew that if God had allowed them to go through it, that God would get them out of it. And this amazed people, because I can imagine if you are in a fire, we would probably be afraid. I don't know what fire it is that you are going through, and sometimes when you are in the fire, you focus more on the fire than you focus more on the God who can quench down the fire. And for them, they realized that God is more powerful than the fire. So even in the fire, you need to think about God. You need to put your focus on God. Be consistent on focusing on God. Do not allow your focus to be on the fire, but allow your focus to be on God in the name of Jesus. The Bible tells me about Joseph. Joseph was betrayed by his own family. His brothers betrayed him, and they actually wanted to kill him. But they decided, instead of killing him, let's just sell him to, you know, just throw him into this, and then, you know, he'll be sold as a slave. But Joseph, even when he was going through all that time, there is nowhere in the Bible that we read that Joseph was discouraged or Joseph, you know, lost hope. But Joseph kept on pressing on, that he became so good at everything that he did, until even in the prison, he was made the head of the prisoners. Can you imagine that? That wherever the trial took Joseph, he took advantage of the trial and became better in the trial. He became a better slave. He became a better prisoner. And because he took advantage and he used the skills that God gave him, even in slavery, until because he was there, the house of Potiphar flourished. The house of Potiphar became better. the house of Potiphar, he became even more wealthier. And even as a slave, he became so good at being a slave that Potiphar even trusted him and did not even treat him as a slave. Child of God, you need to, whatever circumstance you are in, find a silver lining in that circumstance and be better. Grow. In this time of COVID-19, I know there is something that God has blessed you with. Find that which God has given to you and use it to become better. Because Joseph decided to take good advantage and make good use of the trial he was in. The name slave did not even matter to him. But he knew that even if I'm a slave, I'm going to be so good at being a slave that these people, they'll have to know. And even as a prisoner, he was extremely good at being a prisoner. He was obedient, and he actually got the trust of the other prisoners. He was able to become a leader even in the prison, in the name of Jesus. And the Bible even tells me about Paul and Silas in Acts chapter 16 from verses 14, when they were arrested and they were taken to prison. They did not start crying. They did not start saying, "Oh, Mungu meniacha." They did not even complain. They did not whine. What did they do? They started praying and worshiping in prison. And they started praying at midnight. And they started speaking in tongues at midnight. And they started worshiping God, lifting his name up. Saying that, "God, indeed, you're mighty. God, you are powerful." And as they were praying and worshiping, guess what happened? We all know what happened. Amen. And they were able to, God was able to open up the doors of the prison gate because they were praying and worshiping God. Whatever circumstance you are in, focus on God. Let your focus be on God. Your focus should not be on what you're going through. Your focus should be on God, on the person that is helping you go through it, on the person that has allowed you to go through it. If you are a prisoner of the circumstances of your life, you will be a very miserable person because everything will be terrible. You will be discouraged. You will live a life full of hopelessness and despair. How you view the events of your life is more important than the event itself. How you view the events or the circumstances in your life is more important than the circumstance itself. Because the perception of your trial, the mentality that you have when you're going through your trial is more important than the trial itself. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verses 8 to 10. Just read that. In the name of Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, from verses 8 to 10. We get to see the mentality that you get when you're going through the end. It says that we are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Amen. So even though you are hard pressed from the left, from the right, from the north, from the south, from the east to the west, even if you're hard pressed, you are not crushed. Even if you are perplexed with whatever is going on in your life, you are not in despair. You may have been persecuted, but you are not abandoned by God. That you may be struck down, but you are not destroyed, because God is your strength. God is your author and the finisher. God is there for you because you know that you are walking in the will of God. God has allowed you to go through that, but you are coming out with a testimony in the name of Jesus. And you see, our lives are not the product of luck. You're lucky. Our lives are not the product of luck or chance. Our lives is fully the product of the love of God. We are under God's direction. That God guides our steps. That God leads us. And we see this in Jeremiah chapter 10 from verses 23. Jeremiah chapter 10 verses 23. The Bible says that, "Lord, I know that people's lives are not their own. It is not for them to direct their steps." That God, that your life is not your own. It belongs to God. That God is the one who directs your steps. God is the one who guides you and leads you. And even in Proverbs chapter 3 from verses 5 to 6, we see that that God directs our steps. That he leads our steps. He leadeth us. Amen. In the name of Jesus. And you see, The thing that I love about this book of Ephesians is that when Paul was locked up in prison, instead of him sitting there crying, weeping, regretting, complaining, and whining. What he did, he realized that I have a lot of time. That I have a lot of time on my hands. And so I will use this time to write epistles. Epistles are letters to the church. And he also evangelized about Christ in the prison, and people got saved. And you see, Paul wrote four books. They are called the prison epistles. He wrote four books when he was in prison. He wrote Philippians, he wrote Ephesians, he wrote Philemon, and he wrote Colossians when he was in prison, when he was in lockdown. You see, if he was not in prison, he would not have time to write all these letters. He would not have time to write these epistles because he would have been busy moving from one city to another, evangelizing about the gospel of Christ, worshiping God, I mean, performing miracle. So he would not have enough time to be able to sit down, listen from God, and be able to write from, I mean, to be able to write the four books that he wrote in prison. That this time during COVID-19, I know that many of us are in quarantine. For those who are working from home, for those who are not even working from home or from a place of work, right now you have a lot of time in your hands, and you can use this time to be able to come out better, to be able to come out stronger. God has already given you a gift, and you can only use that gift if you focus on God, if your mind is directed to God. Right now is when you can hear from God. Right now is when you can mend those relationships. Right now is when you can create the love and the harmony that has been lost. Right now is when you can even come up with better ideas. You can meditate and see where is it that you need to change and come up with a new plan, because you are listening from God. And Paul wrote of Ephesians when he had been in prison for 5 years. Amen. He wrote all these books when he had been in prison. If he had not been in prison, he wouldn't have probably written these four books. But because he was there, and he decided, instead of me being here and complaining and, you know, and just crying and losing hope, I can write letters to the church. In fact, I can encourage the church. I can be better. I can be able to write to the disciples and write to the servants and write to my sons and write to the church and just hear from God, because that is when he heard from God and he was able to write these epistles. And you see, the Jews thought that they had finished Paul's ministry. They knew that they had put a stop to his ministry, but they did not know that putting him in prison allowed him to be in a position where God could speak through him to many churches. Amen. And God used Paul's imprisonment to expand his ministry to Rome, because Paul was situated mostly in Jerusalem and, you know, all those places that he used to go. But now, because he was in Rome, his ministry had to expand to Rome, because in Rome is where he began, you know, evangelizing and even speaking about the word of God. And so many people were saved in Rome. And from those people that were saved in Rome, they went to still evangelize about God. And I can imagine Joseph's brothers, they thought that when they sold him to slavery, that he was finished. That was it, he was done. But they did not know that when they put him there, when they allowed him to go to slavery, they were pushing him to his destiny. In fact, they helped him get there faster, because by himself he would not have any idea. And so sometimes you need to take whatever circumstance that the devil puts you in. When people put you in a circumstance, sometimes they do not realize that they are pushing you towards your destiny. You see, God's plan and purpose must come to accomplishment. Whatever God has in store for you, it must come to pass in the name of Jesus. God has you where you are because it is in that place that you will bring him the most glory. It is in that place that you will be prepared for the assignment that he has for you. It is in that place where you will grow, where you will develop, where you will be shaped for the glory and honor of his name. You need to grow where God has planted you. And so today I'm just asking you, are you a prisoner of your circumstances? Are you a prisoner of doubt? Are you a prisoner of people's opinions about you? Are you a prisoner of failure? Are you a prisoner of addiction? Are you a prisoner of doubt? or are you a prisoner of Christ? When you are a prisoner of Christ, He makes all the decisions in your life. He guides you. He leads you. He takes you to where He wants you to be for the glory and honor of His name. And as a prisoner of Christ, you can never make a wrong decision because all decisions come from Him. Everywhere you go, He orders the footsteps. He orders every decision that is going on in your life. That before anything happens to you, Jesus has to put a stamp on it. And so I'm just here to encourage you today that God loves you, that God's love is abundant, and that God wants you to allow Him to take charge and control of your life. That He wants to be your everything. He wants to be your all. That even when you are in a place where you feel that you have no strength, He becomes your strength. When you're in a place where you feel that you have despaired, He becomes your encouragement. That when you're in a place where you're facing battles, where you're fighting many things, He fights the battles for you because He is your everything. In the name of Jesus, Father, we glorify Your name. We give You honor. We give You praise. We lift Your name on high, my God. We thank You, my God. We pray that, Lord, today we dedicate our lives into Your able hands. That, Lord, may You take charge of our lives. Lord, may You take control of our lives. That, Lord, we allow You to take the direction. That, Lord, we allow You to take and to make every decision in our lives. That, Lord, we do not want to live by our own understanding. Because we know by our own understanding we will make mistakes. That if we do things by our own understanding, we will not live to accomplish Your purpose in our lives, my God. We pray, my God, I pray for every person who is going through a difficult time. That, Lord, may You be their strength. That, Lord, may You be their encourager. That, Lord, may You be their protector. That, Lord, may You create a testimony for them even in this period, because we know that with You nothing is impossible. We lift our voices to worship You and to honor You. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us and for tuning in. You can support this ministry by sending your love offering through our M-Pesa paybill number 652456, and God is going to bless you. We love you. You are special. God loves you. You are blessed and highly favored in the name of Jesus. Shalom. Amen.
Hamjamboni. Kwa majina anaitwa Priscilla Mwikali Makau. Mimi ni daktari katika hospitali yetu kuu ya Madhare inayoshughulikia mambo na changamoto za akili. Wakati kama huu unaweza kupitia mambo mengi, wafikiria sana, mafikirio yako yalikuwa mengi, yanasongamana, magombana na watu. Tuombe uweze kutumia nambari 1199 ili uweze kupatana na mhudumu wa afya kwa upande mwingine. Pamoja tukomeshe corona.